Hey everybody, welcome back to another week of Mac Outdoors with Mia and Leah. We're happy that you're here. We hope that you will subscribe before you go. And if you've been a listener, we hope that you'll give us a good review on iTunes so that we can be found by other people in searches. Last week, we hope you had fun listening to the crazy outlandish laws that Leah looked up and shared for something fun. This week, since both of us have turkey season starting, we want to talk turkey with you. Stay tuned.
This summer, whether you're at the range or in the field, WSI Sports' HyperTech bamboo tanks, tees, and leggings will have you covered. Visit WSISports.com. And use Leah's affiliate code, LLCO10, for 10% off your purchase. All products are proudly made in the USA. WSI is bringing back pride in American-made clothing. Again, that code is LLCO10 for 10% off your order at WSISports.com.
Hey, hey, everybody. Welcome to the Mac Outdoors podcast, where a dynamic mother-daughter duo share their adventures, tips, and advice. I am Mia, and I'll be accompanied by the one and only daughter, Leah. It is time to get to outdoors, hunt, shoot, and spend time with family and friends. Let's get this show on the road.
So, welcome back. Hey, Leah, I have good news. I know that you already know, but I wanted to tell our listeners as well. This week, the Mac Outdoors podcast became a member of the Self-Defense Radio Network, and we wanted to share that with you and let you know that it's a place that has all of your self-defense and gun podcasts in one location, and you can find them at selfdefenseradio.net. It's pretty good news, huh, Leah?
I think that's awesome. I'm super excited about it.
Yep, me too. I'm hoping that we can collaborate and also learn from some of these other podcast hosts. Yep. So, turkey. What do you have to say about turkey?
We have a love-hate relationship, but I'm pretty excited that season is starting this weekend here and as well as Colorado.
Yep, me too. I'm very excited. And I know I actually probably am more excited about turkey than you because I actually have two young ladies that I'll be guiding opening weekend. And one of them has hunted before, but not the other. So that's pretty cool. I'm excited about that. And another thing is we have way better weather than you do right now.
Yes, I'd have to agree with you there. And you know where the turkeys are. I'm still trying to figure it out.
Mm-hmm. You're still figuring it out, and that's partly because you're busy doing school, right? Just finishing up your first year of college. I'm very proud. I'm so excited for you. But you've been busy, huh?
Yes, I've been trying to focus on just finishing up, so I haven't gotten to go out and scout a lot or shed hunt, which is really just scouting. So
yeah. But wait. You said you haven't gotten out to scout, but you did have an outdoor adventure. Why don't you tell our listeners about your adventure that you had last week?
I did try to go out and hike around and scout the land since I haven't really gotten out to really find where deer and elk are and turkeys. And so I was planning on doing that last weekend, and it didn't work out as planned. Me and one of my friends, we were going to hike a trail that we had found on an awesome app, which we will do a podcast on probably next week.
Oh, yeah, good idea.
And so we started driving up there. She drives a little car, so I volunteered my Toyota truck to do the little off-roading to the trail. And we're going up this little road. Of course, in Montana, it's been snowing / raining, so it's a little of both, and so the snow is a little crunchy up there, and it wasn't too bad. Well, as we start going up in elevation, the snow is getting a little deeper, and all of a sudden, we go from about 6 inches of snow to like 4 feet of snow in a matter of like 100 yards. And we get stuck big time. So instead of spending our day hiking, we spent half the day getting unstuck by ourselves. Luckily, I always come prepared with a shovel and chains for my truck and come along. Everything I'd possibly need, I have it. So that was a plus.
That's awesome.
But it was quite the adventure. I was actually really excited because that was like the most exciting thing that has happened since.
Yeah.
I've been up here.
So. You're like, that is so much more exciting than being in your dorm studying or sitting in class listening to lectures.
How many kids are really out getting trucks stuck in snow and, you know, not studying for a big exam? Luckily that I don't have, so that wasn't an issue, but.
Yeah.
It was pretty exciting. I don't know very many people that would get excited about that, especially someone my age, but.
But it was fun.
It was worth it.
Well, I have to say to anyone who's a parent listening, these are great gifts. I know Leah kind of rolled her eyes one year because it wasn't this year, but a while back, I think when you were a senior in high school, right? For Christmas, she got chains and a come along, and she was kind of like, wait, what? Like,
and straps.
Yeah. And the good thing is she knows how to use them. So that's the really good part. And somebody asked me, well, will she know how to put her chains on when she can't drive over the chains? And so I had to recount an experience. We had a good friend of ours was out hunting one year, and Leah had a one-ton Dodge pickup, and in our part of our driveway, she had went to loop, and her truck slid and almost hit our propane tank. And so she stopped, which I'm glad you did, because we didn't want to take out the propane tank. But she was able to chain it up in the mud, lay down in their mud and chain it up, and she got her truck out. And that was her first experience with chains in our yard. Great learning experiences. I love it.
Good place to learn rather than out in the middle of nowhere by myself.
Exactly. And so I think that was a great thing. And you guys, have you ever had any crazy experiences like that, like Leah has, getting stuck in the woods? It's the first, but who knows if it'll be the last, right?
Definitely will not be the last. Of course, once I got unstuck, I was like, I wonder how much farther we could have made it up that road if I slowed down. So it was probably good that someone else was there.
Yeah.
So I didn't convince myself to go any further.
Yeah, you had a good conscience there on sitting in the passenger seat. So that's good. Save you from getting in too much trouble. So on that, I wanted to ask you, your season starting this weekend, and so is ours, right? How long is the season up there?
It lasts till May 20th, so it's a decent season for hunting these turkeys.
Yeah, and ours goes to the 27th, so it's just 1 week longer than yours. And do you have plans to get out more and go get that shotgun out of the vault and take it in the woods?
I definitely want to. I actually watched Jana Waller of Skullbound, her turkey video of hunting out here, and she did an episode on hunting turkeys here, and it pumped me up, so I'm going to get a tag and go try to find some turkeys to call in.
and I think that's great. That's a good thing to do on your day off. And I know that your co-pilot that you had with you last weekend, she's interested in pursuing turkeys also, right? Isn't she a waterfowl hunter?
Yeah, she hunts a lot of waterfowl, and she was actually the one that gave me the idea to try to get a turkey tag up here in the first place, because I'm not the biggest turkey fan. It's not my favorite thing to hunt, but once I saw that it's more my style of turkey hunting up here, which we will probably discuss a little later.
Absolutely.
I definitely want to get a tag and go for it out here.
Nice. And I'm glad to hear that you had sent that little trailer, and that was really cool because Leah's style, Leah usually likes fall turkey hunting more than springtime turkey hunting. And if you ask me, I would tell you I like springtime. And people say, well, why do you like turkey hunting in the spring? And number one is because you can't hunt elk, right? You can't hunt elk in the spring. So I'm going to hunt turkey. You're like, why not, right? But the second reason is because you can actually call a turkey in like you would an elk. And I think that's really cool. It's a fun challenge to call them in. But Leah, she likes to run and gun, and she's really good at it. And actually, it is fun also. It's kind of like spot and stalk. But so in the fall, Leah, what do you do when you're hunting in the fall?
So in spring, it's more of a sit and call them in kind of deal, and it can last, you know, like 20 minutes or half the day, you know, who knows how long, depending on these birds. And I am very impatient when it comes to sitting and listening to these birds. I know one time I just couldn't wait that extra 5 minutes, even a minute, to get that bird past, I think he was at 60 yards, just a little far. I think I was shooting a 20 gauge at the time, and I just couldn't wait. I got too excited and shot, and he wasn't close enough. So I think with fall turkey hunting, you can actually call him in the fall as well. A lot of our friends will call them in and then bust them up, meaning scaring them away, kind of where they just all run off in different directions, and then you can call them back in again, because it's a lot of the younger poults that were born in the spring are the ones that'll you'll call in a lot of the time, and they're not exactly the smartest ones. In the fall, they'll just come in even however many times you jump them, they'll start coming back in again. And
yeah, and what Leah's not telling you also is that sometimes she'll just go bust up the flock, and she runs right into the middle of them, and she's had a lot of practice with her shotgun, so she knows how to safely maneuver with the shotgun in that. So I don't recommend doing this unless you are very safe with your shotgun, but she will run in there and just run up to the turkey and shoot the one she wants. So run and gun, or run up to him and blast him down. And that's what she has fun doing that, and has been very successful doing that. The first time I was kind of in shock, because, you know, the method is you see the flock, you bust them up, and as she said, call them back. And so I'm like, okay, go bust them up and then we'll call them back. And she just ran up there and shot the turkey. And I'm like, really? Like, here I am. I run like a dump truck with a flat tire. And I'm like, I would never be able to catch up to the turkey, but not Leah. She's she runs like a gazelle.
You have to be pretty sneaky.
Or maybe I should say you're the cheetah, huh? Because you get your prey.
Yeah, you can even do it with a bow. I know I tried that one year, and I actually did one with my bow.
Yeah, that was awesome that year. That was super cool. And so in the springtime, I'm working on a book, but I'm also, I write for Beretta, and I've been working on a turkey hunting series over there. So for people who want to learn more about springtime turkey hunting, I've put some tactics up there for people who are just starting out, and you can find that on my website at Mia Anstein. There's a link to Beretta there. This week, I wrote about how to talk turkey. And Leah can talk turkey with just her mouth. So it's very impressive. And that's something that I've got another friend that I went, he was a cameraman on a girls hunt out with Becky Lou Outdoors. And he can talk without calls as well. So you guys really impress me. But Leah, what do you think, if you could just have one call in the woods, what call would it be besides your mouth?
That is a tough one. I think it really depends. I either like a slate call or sometimes a mouth read, but I don't usually use a mouth read when I can do it on my own.
Right.
I'm not a huge fan of box calls. Just they're squeaky, and if you bump them, if you have them in your turkey vest and bump them, if you're sitting down, they make weird noises, whereas with a slate, you're not going to have the accident of, like, making it squeak all weird. And
right.
And it's easier to use, in my opinion, than dealing with the box call. I feel like it takes a lot more skill kind of to master a box call.
Yeah, and I think you're right as well. And the box call, all the calls you have to keep tuned, but a box call, it seems like you have to keep up with it a lot more, at least the ones that I've had and the one that I have now. So that's something that you need to get is a call. Calls and vests, decoys. Montana Decoy sent me a couple of decoys, which I already had those ones, but they last year worked really well. They're very lifelike and they're super light to carry. So I really like those. I was just shopping or dreaming online yesterday, looking at that Primos, that see-through blind, the surround view. And you don't have to have a blind. And especially that's kind of what Leah's talking about. You can use brush for cover or just keep hiking and spot and stalk and stuff like that.
Yes. With the decoys, what kind are the Montana decoys? I know there's like the foam ones and inflatable ones. What are ones that you would recommend to use?
Well, so the Montana decoys that I had gotten some last year and they sent me some this year to review, but and it's the same set that they sent. It's a Jake and a hen, and I would suggest a Jake rather than a Tom because you can only get a Tom to attract another Tom in a certain part of their breeding season where a Jake isn't going to be as intimidating to a Tom. And it just is going to work better overall the whole season, especially when you have a long season like we do. So I have several kinds of decoys. We have some foam ones. Like Leah said, they're collapsible. They're really light and they blow away in the wind, even though they have a stake to hold them. And sometimes they'll just get to spinning. You have to like make sure there's branches or some grass to keep them from spinning too much. A little movement is good because it makes them look lifelike. We also have some blow up ones that similar issues, you know, if they're too light, then you can have problems. I mean, but then you conversely, you have some heavy ones that, you know, if you're spot and stalking and hiking, then you definitely have a heavy load to carry. And so that's something you need to think about. These ones from Montana Decoy, they actually are kind of like a fabric similar to the antelope or the elk decoys we use. So it's a fabric and it is wrapped around wires and you can just collapse them kind of like a spring and then just put a strap around it and hold it. So they fold up to about 9 inches in diameter and then maybe 1 inch thick and fit really nice in the pack. And then they're just heavy enough that they don't fly away or float away. So I really liked those last year. They also look very lifelike. They aren't really fake. Some of those blow up ones get shiny, or the foam ones, some of them are shiny.
I think with those foam ones too, I've noticed like the ones that we've had for a while, the color rub off on them. If they're a Jake with their red head and little blue on there, it seems like that color ends up rubbing off as you pull them in and out of your vest or backpack all the time.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Yeah. So, and I think it's also a matter of preference for different people, how far out they're having to hike, where they're going in the woods and stuff like that. And as you know, we've killed a lot of turkeys without any decoys at all. So decoys aren't required.
Yes.
Yes. They really help. I like them, especially when you were young and with some of the new hunters, they're a great distraction while you're trying to get your hunter or the shooter prepared for their shot. When we're turkey hunting, as I said, out here, it is during the day about 70 degrees. In the morning, it's still in the 20s. So layers are definitely required. But what would you say about weather, Leah, when you're turkey hunting? What are some ups and downs?
Well, especially with the spring, the weather can be really nice 1 minute and the next minute it's pouring rain or snowing or who knows what it's doing. So I think you always have to be prepared for the worst, rather it be scorching hot or freezing hail or rain. I know 1 year we got hailed on and pouring rain on us and we didn't have our rain gear or anything. So I think that was our, here's your sign that you need to start packing some good rain gear.
Yeah. I think I actually just shared that as a throwback Thursday on my website.
That was one of my favorite hunts. Even though we got dumped on and hailed on, and that's what comes in good, good product to purchase is the Z-Rest capsules or
a barrel plug?
Yeah. If you buy the Z-Rest little pills or barrel plug, so when your gun does get soaking wet, it won't rust.
Yeah, that is a great suggestion. And especially because sometimes, and Leah's saying this because we've had it happen, you think that you got your gun all dried off before you put it in the case, but it wasn't. And so those Z-Rest capsules, and like you said, that barrel plug, they are great to help wick away that last bit of moisture that was in the cracks or inside where you couldn't see it. Super good things. Yeah. I actually, this year, I look forward to trying something. It's called a Zippo 6-Hour Green Rechargeable Hand Heater. And it looks like a bean, and it's about 2.5 inches long and about 1 inch thick. You can use it to charge your phone or other devices, and just like our solar chargers, and it's a hand warmer. So I'm like hoping to see how that one works this weekend, because I know it's going to be super cold in the morning and my hands are going to be chilly. So I'm going to try that Zippo heater.
Hand warmers are a good thing.
Yeah, and doesn't it seem like we always have the little hot hands, and it seems like when you're freezing cold, they are never warm. But then when you're like in the truck headed back home, they're like burning up in your pocket.
Yes. You need to like break them open right when you leave the truck, and then when you're at your hunting spot, then hopefully they'll be warm a little bit.
Yeah, hopefully they'll warm up by then. But I thought this rechargeable one, I've got it charged up already. I've used it when I've been out on the tractor harrowing and stuff. I've used it to charge my phone while I'm listening to my music. And it actually, in just like an hour, will charge my phone while I'm using it. So it's pretty powerful. It's really cool.
That's nice.
Yeah. You know, I don't think the butane ones can do that. What other cool things do you think for inclement weather? What other things would you recommend? Or did you say... like stay home. You were reading some tips and one of them said if it's bad weather, stay home.
Yeah, I was reading actually the Montana Parks Wildlife and Fish site. They were saying when it's bad weather here that the turkeys aren't active and you can't really call them, which is actually true. When the weather is really bad, they won't call as much just because the weather is pouring rain. They're just hunkering down. So I thought that was kind of interesting because you could be there and it'll just be raining till, I don't know, 8 in the morning, and then it'll clear up and they'll fly the roost. So I don't think it's necessary to stay home when you could be chasing these turkeys only. I think in really harsh weather, I haven't spent a spring up here in Montana, but when it's still snowing in April, I think they are saying stay home when it's basically a blizzard out. I know in Colorado, we usually don't have that bad of weather most days.
Yeah, so that makes sense.
I figured we could wrap up this episode with some turkey fun facts that I found while doing some research, and I just thought they were pretty interesting stuff about turkeys that I really didn't know a lot about.
All right, tell us all about it.
An adult wild turkey has approximately 5,500 feathers.
Wow, that's a lot of feathers.
18 of the iconic tail feathers.
Oh, wow. Interesting.
I feel bad for whoever had that job.
Whoever counted all of those.
Whoever counted all those feathers. Another one, a wild turkey can run up to 25 miles per hour.
Nice.
And can fly up to 55 miles per hour, which those things have a hard time getting off the ground as is. So that's pretty impressive.
Yeah, that is impressive.
Wild turkeys have vision that is 3 times better than humans, and they can see across 270 degrees, which does bring up a good point that they say don't wear colors at all when you're turkey hunting.
Yep.
In one of the articles I read, it said don't wear red or blue or white. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people say don't wear blaze orange because they can see that.
Right. What about blaze pink?
I am not positive.
I would say no. No bright colors. That's the rule.
No colors. Just camo.
Camo is a color.
This is really interesting. Wild turkeys were nearly extinct in the 1930s because they were overhunted and habitat loss.
Yep, that is a fact. And that's one of the greatest conservation models in the United States, is how through hunting and conservation, they've actually brought the populations back. Does that tell you how many turkeys we have in the country now?
It doesn't say what the population is now.
I would have to look the exact number up, but we have hundreds of thousands of turkey in the United States now, and they are far from being extinct, but it's been through hunting and management that we've been able to grow those populations. And there are similar numbers with other wildlife that we hunt today.
Another fun one is a turkey's gobble can be heard up to 1 mile away.
Oh, wow. And that's a cool sound to hear echoing through the mountains.
It always gets you excited. I think it's just like listening to an elk bugle. You hear that turkey gobble far away and you're like, oh my gosh.
What? Oh my gosh. They're over there.
Not hunting them. An interesting one. Turkeys were honored by both the Mayans and the Aztecs, and were often with special religious ceremonies.
That's interesting. I didn't know that fact.
Of course, with turkeys, there is Thanksgiving. The first presidential pardon of a domestic turkey for Thanksgiving was 1947.
And has that been done every year since, do you suppose?
I believe so.
I think it has, huh?
Oh, here's a statistic that with the population of turkeys that we were just discussing that I just found, there are more than 7 million wild turkeys, and they can be legally hunted in many states.
And they are fun to hunt. And there are different species to hunt in different parts of the country. We have Merriam's down here in our area. And then is that what you have up there also, Leah?
Yeah, we also have Merriam's.
That's pretty cool. You'll at least know what those turkeys look like.
Yeah. Well, and close to home, too, there are Rios.
Mm-hmm.
Just a few miles away, so.
Nice.
Last one, the wild turkey is the official game bird of Alabama, Massachusetts, and South Carolina.
Excellent. Those sound like great states.
Anything that honors a turkey.
Oh, yeah.
That's all right.
A wild turkey. That's very cool. So on that note, thank you for those fun facts. Those are some pretty cool things. Some I knew, but there are quite a few that I didn't know. So that's awesome. To you, our listeners, let us know what fun facts you knew and didn't know. We have, since we're a member of the Self-Defense Radio Network now, we've created social media sites for Mac Outdoors. So we have Instagram. It's Mac_Outdoors. We have Facebook. It's at facebook.com/MacOutdoorsLLC. And then Twitter is at MacOutdoorsLLC. And we hope that you'll go follow us there and subscribe. And then you can comment and like and tell us all your news over on those sites.
If you want to know more about turkeys and turkey hunting, I would suggest looking into the National Wild Turkey Federation. They do a lot of conservation work. And if you own land that has a lot of turkeys, they even have a little fundraiser deal that they can help you plant on your property to bring turkeys and bring back populations. So check them out. They are a great organization.
They are. That's a great idea. Thanks for sharing that, Leah. And until next week, you guys have a great one. Talk to you later.
Thanks for tuning in.